Today I'm talking about writing C code that creates and works with Rust objects over FFI. This is pretty easy if your struct is boring, but it gets more interesting once you start adding things like generics. Along the way, we'll look at some trait objects in detail and do some weird stuff. Let's start with a simple non-generic example. Here's a struct called myValue. It's public, which means I'll be able to refer to it externally, but it's not repr C, which means we won't expose its field. We won't try to expose its field. On the C side, it will be an opaque struct that we can only refer to via a pointer. Now that I have it, I can define some FFI methods to work with it. As you can see, my struct contains some value, U32 in this case, which is chosen on the Rust side. I have a function to allocate one on the heap by putting it in a box, then giving ownership to C with into raw. I then have a function to free it again by taking ownership of the memory with from raw, then dropping it. I also have a third function that prints out the debug representation of the contents of whichever my value pointer gets passed in. So far, so good. If I build it with cbindgen configured, it will generate a header file for me. And that header file looks like this. I have my struct definition. It's opaque. I also have my function prototypes. I can now use these from C code. So here's a basic program that includes that header file. It makes a struct. It calls the method to print it, and then it frees it. So I can build this C program. I'm just using a small script to automate the things that I need to do for that. It's not especially fancy. And as you can see, it does pretty much what we expect. It creates one, asks it to print itself, and then frees it. In all these functions, the key thing we're passing around is a pointer to a struct myValue. Let's have a closer look at that in the debugger for the C program. So we'll set a breakpoint on the main function and run it. So we're about to create one. Let's go to the next one so it actually gets created. Now we have some value, some pointer inside the variable mv. Let's just have a quick look at our mappings, if I type it correctly. Mappings. Okay. This address range is where our heap allocations currently are. And if I do info local, we can see that mv is a pointer into 810010. So that's right at the start of our current heap memory region. So that's pretty much what we expect. Now let's have a look at what's actually contained inside that. This is just reading one 4-byte integer from the memory pointed to by mv, and we see that it's the number 4. So that's sort of what we would expect. It's a pointer to the struct, and if we sort of extend that out, okay, we've got some zeros after it, but there's not really anything else interesting going on. So at a higher level, this is what we've confirmed. The return value for myValue create is just a memory pointer. That's a memory address. And we found the content of that struct laid out in memory at that address, 132-bit integer. So far, hopefully this makes sense. But there is something important that isn't there. Let's focus just on the print function for a moment. The only thing that we pass in is a memory location. How does it know that the address we passed in actually belongs to a myValue struct? How does it know that it's going to find a U32 at that memory location? What if we gave it the address of some different kind of struct? How would it know? And the answer is that it wouldn't know. When we say that the argument is a pointer to a myValue, we're telling it that that's what it should be. Then when we convert that pointer into a Rust reference, we have to do that unsafely. We're telling the compiler, treat this memory location as a myValue struct. We could have 100 kinds of structs, and maybe some of them contain an integer and some of them don't. The type of the struct itself is not stored in memory. It's completely contextual. But because we sent the pointer to this particular function, it's going to assume the memory is this particular struct, and we end up treating it like one, for better or worse. Now, what if my struct was generic? At the moment, this has no type parameters, but we could imagine a program which has a struct which is. This time we have our field X is a as a generic type D. It's something that implements debug so that we can print a representation of it to the screen. So now I have to adjust my functions accordingly to deal with this. My create and free functions are going to create a U32 variant explicitly, same as before. However, I've made the print function completely generic here. In normal Rust code, we could pass it any kind of my value, including U32, and it would just do what we expected to do. The compiler would know how to make that work. But when I build this one, something else happens. This time, I get a strange warning that the print function has to be mangled. And if I go and look at the library, what's it called? My value. We can see that the print function is missing. It hasn't actually exported it. It's not available from C. And if we think about it, what we're trying to do just isn't possible. When we receive a pointer to a my value from C, we have no idea what the generic type D is. We have the memory address where the data is stored on the heap, but what format is that data? It could be a U32, it could be a U8, it could be a string. This is essentially an impossible situation. So we can fix this by specifying the types exactly. And here's an example of how you could do that. Now instead of having three functions, we have six. We've got the create free print for U32 and the create free print for a string type. And, you know, it is because it's a generic type, we can store a string in there if we want. And this works. And then so if you run this through cbindgen, you end up getting all of these functions being created. But it's kind of annoying because then in your C program, you have to specify, I want a U32 type, and I want to print the U32 type, and I want to free the U32 type. This is annoying. You know, what if I don't know or care what the type is? Maybe sometimes I create one and it gives me one that has a U32 inside. Sometimes I create it and it has a string inside and I don't even know. Is there a way that we could write our Rust code and export our FFI to make this possible? And the answer is yes, we can do this by using traits. We can define a trait that doesn't have any type parameters. So we can construct my value U32 or a my value string like before, and it doesn't matter what type it is so long as it implements debug. And now for all of those values, any my value where D is debug, we have implemented the trait my trait. So now we can sort of represent this entire set of objects. Anything that could be a my value D can be represented as a my trait for all of them. So that's all mapped to just one type, which is very interesting from an FFI perspective. The goal now is to make our FFI functions refer to this single trait rather than having to specify exactly which struct we're using in each case. As we discussed just a moment ago, the main problem is that when we receive a pointer from C, we don't know what type of struct it is. We've lost the contextual type information. We only know the location of the actual data struct on the heap. A trait object in Rust fixes this problem by tacking on an extra piece of information. It not only has a pointer to the data, but also a pointer to a vtable. I don't want to get into what exactly a vtable is, but it's an extra piece of information that effectively identifies what kind of struct it actually is. So if you created a myValue U32 and decided to refer to that as a trait object of type myTrait, that would have a particular vtable. And then if you create another myValue U32, the same type but a different instance, it will have a different data location but the same vtable. And then if you go on to create a my value string, it's a different instance again, so it has its own data, but then it will have a different vtable corresponding to the string variant. And we'll prove this in the debugger in a little bit. So hopefully things are making sense, because it's about to get a little bit weird. Let's look more closely at the FFI functions relating to my trait. When I create the object, I'm creating it on the heap with box new, but instead of storing it as a box my value, it's a box my trait. This variable v actually consists of these two pointers, the data plus the vtable, that's just hidden from you in the Rust source code. I then give up ownership of it to the FFI and return the pointer. But it's not a normal pointer, it's a wide pointer, din my trait. Also notice that in this code there's a 50-50 chance that we'll get either a U32 type or a string type. Both of these can be converted to the same type of trait object, so Rust is cool with it. So having created that, our other functions receive the same wide pointer type as an argument. What's nifty now is that when we want to print it out, the wide pointer, the trait object, by itself contains enough information about what type it is. We can just call v.print, and behind the scenes it will end up doing the right thing for a U32 one or the right thing for a string one. It's the same old trait object that we know and love from normal Rust code that enables this kind of functionality. So let's make sure that we can actually build our library like this. Great. Now let's look at the function prototypes that cbindgen created for us. Oh dear, cbindgen has decided that we're nuts. You see, our create function's return value is no longer a standard memory address, which would be 64 bits on this machine. It's actually two 64-bit things jammed together, the data and the vtable. And to make things worse, this trait object is kind of an internal data type that we're not really supposed to be relying on. But, you know, maybe we can do it anyway. Let's have a quick look at the library, again using nm. Okay, grep t. So, we can see that the functions have actually been compiled and exported in the library. So the functionality is there, we just don't have the appropriate definitions for our C program. No problem, we can write them ourselves, I guess. So, first we need a struct describing the wide pointer that we're expecting to get back from the create function. As we saw, we expect it to be two pointers, one after the other. And this is returned by the create function. Then the same type of wide pointer is passed as a parameter to the print function and to the free function. So in the main program body, what it's going to do is it's going to create three trait objects. Remember, there's a 50-50 random chance which type it will be. Then it will ask for us to print the contents of each of the three and then free them. So let's compile and run that C program a few times to see what it does. Okay. We can see that randomness is taking effect there. And now we have a C program that is actually getting references to different types of generic my values and still able to work with them. So we've achieved our dream, basically. We've hidden this information. We've erased the generics from the C side. All the necessary magic is actually built into the trait object, which is already part of Rust. But we had to jump through quite a lot of hoops here, specifying a trait object struct and all of our functions manually in C. Is there a way to fix that? And of course there is. It's almost a bit silly, but it works really quite well. You just have to put the box in another box. Now, I can't actually take credit for this idea. I read it a while back or somewhere on the Rust users forum, but it's a stroke of genius, honestly. What do I mean by put a box in the other box? Well, in the current code, we have our my value struct stored on the heap behind a data pointer, and we end up with this wide pointer stored on the stack. We return it from the create function. What we're going to do instead is create a new 128-bit allocation on the heap to store our trait object, those two pointers. So now that's on heap memory. Then we take the address of that and give that to C. In other words, C has a pointer to a trait object, a pointer to a wide pointer. And C doesn't have to realize that that's what it is at all, because it can just treat it as opaque. But it means that when Rust unpacks this pointer, it has another layer of indirection to go through. So here's our old print function. It takes a trait object pointer. And here is our new print function. It's the same, except now the trait object parameter is boxed. The wide pointer on the inside is two pointers jammed together, but the pointer on the outside is just a normal 64-bit pointer to some opaque object on the heap from C's point of view. So in theory, C bind gen will create a prototype for it. Let's find out. Okay, that hasn't actually worked. So there's a bit more dodginess here. The reason that C bindgen is not happy here, it's not because we've done anything wrong, it's just that it's seeing the din keyword in these definitions and thinking, oh no, this is something that we can't handle. But we know better than C bindgen, so whoops. What I'm going to do is simply remove those din keywords, which actually will generate a warning on recent versions of Rust, because they're making it so that you have to specify din. But for now, we'll just take that out and run the build again. There's those warnings. Now let's look at the .h file again. Lovely, that's worked. So now that we've successfully tricked C bindgen into thinking that everything's fine, it's created an opaque struct of type box my trait. Is that the only side effect with this technique is that you end up with this box prefix on everything. You could do your own type def to fix that, I suppose. But now everything is looking pretty good. We have our three methods that we've defined, and we just need to make our C program use the correct name. So we've gotten rid of all that boilerplate where we had to define the trait object and all that. It's just not there anymore. So we create three of them, and now they're pointers. They're actual pointers as C knows them. And we pass those pointers into the print functions, and then we free them. So let's build and run that program. Great, and that's working perfectly. Now, just to prove that this is doing what we think it is, let's have a closer look at some of those objects in the debugger. So I'm just going to step forward a few instructions so that MT1, 2, and 3 have all been given my values, and we have all the pointers. So we can hopefully see those. There they are. Now let's actually inspect some of the memory inside these things. Those look like heap addresses, so let's look at what's actually on the heap. We sort of expect to see two pointers at that address. Oops. Certainly looks like two pointers. Let's have a look at the other ones as well. Okay. This is looking pretty good. So we've got three different data pointers and two different kinds of vtable pointer. So the first my value is one type, and the two other values are some other type. And to prove that, let's step three more times and watch what gets printed. Okay, first one was a string, and then the two ones that are the same were actually numbers. Now let's have a quick look at the contents of the data pointer. In theory, this is just going to be a number, the number 4. And there it is. It's probably going to be the same for the other number 1. And then the string is going to be something completely different. In fact, it's going to be probably several pointers or something. Yeah, length 5, capacity 5, that's probably more data. X16C, that. Okay, and finally we find the contents of our string in some buffer there. So we've come to the end of the demonstration. We started out with a simple non-generic struct, and we can send simple pointers back and forth over FFI with no problems. Then we tried to make it generic, and it just didn't work very well. The incoming pointer didn't contain enough information to decide how to print it. We ended up having to create different sets of functions so that the correct type could be inferred by context, depending on which function we were calling, which is just not that fun. So then we explored the idea of using a trait to paper over the differences between different generic structs. This works great. Trait objects are built into Rust to solve exactly this kind of problem, but dealing with wide pointers from C is kind of annoying. Finally, we said, well, why don't we just put the wide pointers on the heap? Then we have a normal thin pointer to give to C. And this works mostly pretty great. I have no idea how you're going to use this information, but I hope you enjoyed it. Cheerio.